By 1978, he had become one of the most revered figures in global intelligence, as illustrated by the collection of medals, ceremonial daggers, handwritten letters, and awards he had acquired. As usual, he went to the Far East and took in Australia, New Zealand, and India en route to the Middle East, where, in Tehran, he met with the Shah of Iran. By early 1978, Oldfield's promise to the Shah that he would not allow MI6 to spy in Iran on his watch was already looking like a mistake, even if few were to predict the enormity of what would happen a year later. The reason for Oldfield's promise had been by showing trust to encourage the Shah to move the Iranian economy towards a more Western model, and to an extent that happened. But the Westernization of the economy did not extend to improving democracy, and as early as the mid-1970s, the regime was trying to brook opposition to the changes, and the jails were slowly filling up with political prisoners. The economic changes began to alienate the conservative Shia Muslims, led by the Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini, exiled in Iraq. And though there was no war, the rumblings of unrest were heard. Another Muslim leader, Ali Sharati, who had served 18 months in jail for preaching, died unexpectedly in June 1977 from a heart attack in Southampton, to where he had fled to avoid further persecution by the Shah's authorities. In October, Khomeini's son, Mustafa, also died unexpectedly from a heart attack. Rightly or wrongly, the anti-Shah protesters blamed the Iranian intelligence service, SAVAK, which had been oppressing left-leaning and liberal political movements for both deaths. With that, and a resurgence of the feeling that the Shah was a puppet of the West, the unrest continued to grow into 1978. Even then, things might have been averted had the Shah taken steps to rein in his behaviour and caught the more liberal-minded Muslims. Instead, the Shah urged the then Vice President of neighbouring Iraq, Saddam Hussein, to drive Khomeini out of his country. Rather than solving the problem, this subsequent exile of Khomeini, with Saddam's support, this time to Paris, merely made the canny cleric a kind of living martyr, and he used the world's media to portray himself as a victim of the Shah's oppression.